So sometime in the late 50s and 60s, the idea that children were to be seen and not heard began to gain popularity. Many of you may be familiar with this idea, especially depending on your religious background. Depending on how conservative the church was that you went to, you may have experienced it. The idea is actually rooted in some 15th century religious idea, and it was partly influenced at that time, in the 50s and 60s, by a theory that if you gave too much attention to your babies or children, they may become emotionally damaged. Thankfully, we passed that time. But this morning, we're going to be looking at what the Bible has to say about children. While doing some relief work in Haiti following a devastating earthquake, a volunteer observed the tragedy of building concrete houses with too much sand mixed in and not enough structural steel to reinforce it. Sand is cheap. So when many impoverished Haitians built their cement block homes, they used more sand than they should in their mortar mix. Because steel is expensive, they didn't use enough steel to reinforce the structure. So when the ground began to quake, their homes crumbled. There was way too much sand and not enough steel. It was a tragedy of poverty. In our own poverty of spirit, we try to build our lives this way. We build marriages with too much anger and not enough love, and they crumble. We build families on too much busyness and not enough time, and they crumble. The author of the Psalms 127 has strong words about what it means or what happens when we try to build our lives with impoverished spirits. Psalms 27. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is in vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives his beloved sleep. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb a reward. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are the children of one's youth. Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them. He shall not be put to shame when he speaks with his enemies in the gate. What does house mean in this context? It can mean many things. It can mean temple, palace, it can mean prison even, or even a dynasty such as the house of David. But most of the time in the Bible it means a household, our immediate family. And the majority of this passage speaks of children. And for me, it makes sense to conclude that the major theme of this psalm is children. Of course, being a youth pastor, I'm probably biased. So you can hold that against me if you want. But regardless, that's what we're going to be focusing on this morning. So with that in mind, I'm going to go through the first two verses quickly. Without God's involvement, our efforts are for naught. It's like we are adding too much sand when we are building our homes. Without God, they crumble. Jesus proclaimed, "For what profit will it be a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul?" Any success we have is because God has willed it so. Let me be clear. I'm not saying that there are no good households apart from God or following God. There are some. Maybe many. But just as Jesus said, only God is good. And James, his brother, he said, every good and perfect gift comes from Father above. Those families that seem to be good are only that way because God has given them that ability. And God's involvement means he is their help. In contrast to vanity, the psalm moves into gifts. There's only one way to interpret this. Children, according to the psalmist, and to God, are gifts, rewards from God. I know sometimes it doesn't seem that way, especially in the throes of tantrum. Or if those of you who have had kids, women specifically, during the labor pains. But every moment of precious, adorable acts are certainly a reward. The privilege of watching them grow up is a reward. When we are old and in need, the children aiding us in that need, that's a reward. Now, I have to stop here, just for a moment. With all this talk of gifts and rewards, I have to address a question that some people may have. They may be asking themselves, since I cannot have children, does that mean God doesn't want me to have a reward? I did. And truthfully, I can't tell you why God has not given you a child. But I can tell you that God has another gift. And if I could suggest without devaluing your children or your experience, that God's own son, his child, and the gift he has given us is worthy, is valuable. That one day, that gift will allow us to sit face to face with him. And that experience will make all the pain, and disappointment, and anger melt away. The implication that God is involved, the idea that he's involved in giving children, has big implications for us in this verse. God's involvement means there's no vanity with children, regardless of the outcome. It also means that God is in the midst of our labors, helping us to parent, mentor, and disciple children. 10 years ago, from what I've been told, there are only about 6 people who attended church on Sunday here. Today, on an average, we have 90 to 100. And according to my understanding of church economics, or churchonomics, that means there are close to 150 to 200 people who call this church their home and attend it with some kind of regularity. I believe that this is a direct result of what you and the elders and the leadership team have decided as part of our vision here. To be a nurturing family of faith, especially for children and youth. Jesus teaches that we must receive the kingdom of God like children. It belongs to those who are like them. The greatest person in heaven will be like a child, will be childlike in humanity. And to hinder children from coming to Jesus is wrong. All these verses paint a vivid picture that children are important to God. He's directly involved in giving them to us as blessing and gifts. And he cares for them because he believes they are precious. And they are. If God is involved, do we need to labor? There are usually 3 ways people tend to view this. God does nothing and we do everything. God does everything and we do nothing. Or God does everything and we do something. If we take a look at the first 2 verses, each laborer, the builder and the watchman, both labor at their tasks. The distinction is that God is not involved in them. Not whether he's doing all the work. To me, it's clear that we are required to labor, even when God is helping us. And personally, I view it along the lines of this, that I am allowed to be some small part of his plan. All my efforts and abilities are ultimately the result of his providing the skill and the strength needed for it. The psalmist talks about children being like arrows. The skill to be proficiently in archery is quite great. More so then than now. We have a few more advancements in types of bows. Warriors typically trained from the time they were children, so that they would one day be able to draw a bow with a weight of about 90 pounds on the string and shoot accurately 300 to 400 yards. If you can imagine the skill it would require to shoot accurately from horseback during full gallop, that's a That's a lot of skill. But the distinction in this metaphor here is children are like arrows. We must diligently labor, like practicing orders, and teaching them how to fly straight and true, and influencing them where to go. Like arrows, children must be let go, released to fly. Giving in to fear and letting our children miss the mark is worse than not preparing them. What can a child learn if they do not fail? When we miss a target in archery, we can walk over and pick it up. Dust the arrows off, maybe change the feathers on them, and try again. So too, we must we let children miss the mark, pick themselves up, and try again. Here's another saying you may have heard. It takes a village to raise a child. It's an old African proverb. Raising children, however, starts at home. Parents have the most influence on children. What direction they will eventually take, flight. It is in large in part of how they were raised, how they were influenced by them. But the proverb is true. You do not do this in isolation. Those who surround the children influence them. If you will picture with me an archery target with a red bullseye at the center, alternating white and red circles surrounding it, those represent the different levels of influence, the most powerful being the center. They are the parents. The remaining rings are made up of friends or teachers. Any relationship the child values, being good or bad, doesn't matter. They can be part of those other rings. Here at the Gathering Place, we have made it our mission to care for youth and children, to be lights, to influence for good their direction, so that when they take flight like an arrow, they fly straight, seeking God, replacing their parents' influence with God's influence. This may seem like an impossible task, possible to get perfect. However, the reality is we don't need to be perfect at this. We have a helping hand. Remember, when God's involved, which He is with children, He's on our side. He's laboring with us, and there is no vanity. As parents, there are a few things we can do to help us influence children for good. We could partner and acknowledge God's role. We could teach them about God by praying with them, reading Bible stories to them. Children can be just as busy as adults. And so we must, like adults, stop and leave room for God in their lives. We can try and live an example of a good Christian life. And lastly, but not least, we can seek positive peer pressure through youth groups, Sunday schools, the Wanderer Church. For the rest of us, who are parents, and in fact, really for everyone here, I have this to suggest. Our mission here at the Gathering Place is to fulfill the Great Commission. Our vision is to do so by being a nurturing family of faith that especially cares for children. TGP, I tell you today, make every effort to support this vision. We all have a role to play in everyone's lives here today, in the community around us. We could be a nurturing family of faith, supporting parents, individuals, and most specifically, with regards to this verse, children, youth. Let us be an influence of good, so that they may fly straight and true.